गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। आज वी ऑल नो दैट वी हैव कंप्लीटली डबल फिफ्थ फाइव यूनिट्स इन अवर सर्विंग वन। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद द नेक्स्ट यूनिट दैट इज रिलेटेड टू योर हाइड्रोग्राफिक सर्विंग विच इज द लास्ट यूनिट इन योर सर्विंग वन लेक्चर सीरीज। ओके, सो बेसिकली हाइड्रोग्राफिक सर्विंग इज जनरली डन फॉर सम हाइड्रोलॉजिकल ऑब्जर्वेशन, ओके, विच आर नेसेसरी फॉर द डिजाइंस ऑफ वॉट। सो इफ यू आर ऑब्वियसली बाई द नेम इट सेल्फ इट कैन यू कैन guess it that it is related to somewhat water structures. So it is related to what hydraulics and marine structures for design of it can be used. Hydraulic surveys are generally used for what? Design of dams, barrages, weirs and cross drainage works. A knowledge of amount of rainfall in the catchment area and the discharge through the river are essential. So how much rainfall can be covered in a single catchment area? Okay, that is also sometimes very important. Again, for the designs of port, docks, harbor, lighthouses, etc., and the location of hills, sandbars under the sea, shoreline, and tidal survey and echo sounding are extremely very important. Hydrographic surveying includes the following. So all these things comes under which part? It comes under hydrographic surveying. So if you are making design for your dams or weirs or cross drainage work, you will require to do hydrographic surveying. Okay, sometimes how much rainfall can be covered in a single catchment area is also important. It is required to calculate what the discharge. Okay, next it can also be used for design of ports, docks, harbors, lighthouses. Okay, so these are all the uses where you can use your hydrographic surveys. Okay, so basically hydrographic surveying includes the following three category. One is your rain gauging. Okay, second is your river gauging. Next is your marine surveying. So these three classification of your hydrographic surveying. Firstly, we'll start with your rain gauging. So the amount of rainfall in a catchment area or a basin or a river is generally recorded. This helps to predict the probable runoff through the basin or a river. Thus, any probable flood in the downstream area may be forecasted in heavy rain and necessary precaution may be taken to avoid the disaster. So basically, why rain gauging has been done? Because with the help of rain gauges, we can predict whether how much rainfall has been collected in a certain area or in a certain catchment area, and they can, with the help of that data, we can predict the chances of flood. Okay, so the people living on so the properties or the people living on the downstream side can be protected in case of heavy rainfall. Okay, for that purpose rain gauging has been done. The next one, location site for rain gauges. This is also very important, which site is to be selected for rain gauges. Rain gauges station are somewhat like this. This is a Simpson rain gauge, okay, which is normally used to collect rain. Okay, next one, the recommended network of rain gauge station depends upon the topography of the catchment area. So how to place your rain gauge station, it depends upon the catchment area. Okay, so generally one rain gauge for every 500 kilometer square for a plain area. So for if there is the area is plain, then it is generally placed at 500 kilometer square, and for 150 kilometer square for hilly areas. So if the area in which you are using your rain gauges is hilly, so the distance will be 150 kilometer, and if it is plain area, then it is 500 kilometer square. To get the proper rainfall record from the catchment area, the station should be selected that they may fully cover the basin. So the main criteria is that if you are selecting a particular station, it should at least cover the required basin. Or okay, the following point should be recommended by selecting the rain gauge station. So these points should be kept in mind while selecting the station for your rain gauges. Firstly, it should be established on a level ground, okay, and not on a sloping ground. So it should be perfectly on a level ground, it should not be on a sloping ground. That is one of the main criteria. Second one, they should be not close to any permanent structure or tree. So it should be not near any permanent structure or tree, otherwise it will obstruct the rain and you will not get your proper reading. Next one, they should be protected from high winds. Obviously you should be protected from high wind, because in case of high wind, they might damage your rain gauge station. Okay, so it should be protected from high wind. they should be accessible. Obviously, if you are keeping your railway station, you will have to collect data from there, so it should be accessible. Otherwise, it will be difficult for you to reach over there and record your rain data. So these are the four conditions which are important while selecting the location site for your railway station. Okay, the first one, it should be on a level ground. It should be on a it should be away from any permanent structure. It should be protected against wind. It should be accessible. Okay, next one. So there are various type of rain gauge systems available. So how you have to measure the rainfall? The rainfall is recorded in different type of rain gauges, such as non-recording type and recording type or automatic rain gauge. So basically, we have two type of rain gauge system. One is your non-recording type, and second one is your recording type, which works automatically. The construction operation of rain gauge system are described as below. So the Simpson rain gauge system has been given below. Okay. So it consists of a glass bottle over here. It consists of a funnel over here. So whatever water gets collected in this funnel and it has been received in this, and there is a graduation mark on this bottles. With the help of that, you can measure how much millimeters of rain has been collected. Okay. Normally the reading has been taken 24 hours. Okay. And it is generally taken every morning 8:30 every day. Okay. So it only works for 24 hours, and at every morning you will have to check the readings. Okay. This is how your measurement has been done. After that, river gauging. So this is your rain gauging that we have done. After that, there is river gauging. So in river gauging involves the measurement of discharge of a river. So in river gauging, what you are doing, we are measuring the discharge. How much discharge of a river has been happening, that we have to find it out, that we have to measure, and the establishment of gauge post on one of its bank. So in order to measure the discharge, you will have to establish what gauge post on its bank. Okay, this is done directly read to HFL high flood level, so that the warning may be given to the surrounding area for any precaution measures to be taken if it is necessary. So why this has been done, river gauging, why it has been done? Obviously, if you are doing river gauging, what will happen? You will have to record data which will tell you that under which condition there can be chances of high flood level. Okay. So that is the reason we are doing river gauging. Okay. So with the help of river gauging, we can get what data which will provide us necessary information so that we can take precautionary measure, and the people living nearby the river can be informed before any disaster can happen. Okay. That is the reason why river gauging has been done. In addition, river gauging is undertaken for the following reason. So there are some reasons why it has been done. To fix the number of span of roads and railways so that unexpected high flood may not cause any damage to structure. So some of the reasons are given why river gauging has been done: to fix number of span of roads, for fixing the span of the roads and railway bridges. Okay, so in order to avoid any flood, high flood that will cause damage, because you must have seen some of the roads which are very near to your river. There you must have seen some of the road bridges, railway bridges, which are moving over the river. So it is necessary that we have the data for this. Otherwise, what will happen? Because based on this data, we will create the height of your road, will create the height of your bridge, so that it does not get affected even in case of high flood. Okay, so that is why river gauging is required, to fix the height of the guide bank. Okay, this is the reason why we are using river gauging, to fix the spillway level and the height of the dam or the barrage. So the spillway level is where the water has been taken out from your dams or the river. So if it has been not properly designed with the help of flood data, it will get affected by that structure. To design the cross drainage work when canal crosses a river. Okay, so it is also used for cross drainage work when the canal crosses a river. So these are some of the reasons why you are doing river gauging. Okay, now where to select the discharging site? Okay, the first selection point is where. So the selection of site is important, where you will measure the quantity of discharge. So the following point should be remembered while selecting a discharge site. A river should be a strait for a minimum length of 500 meter or 4 times its width. So one of the main criteria of selecting the site, selection of a site for discharge, is that the river should be straight for approximately length of about 500 meter, or if it is not 500 meter, it should be at least 4 times the width of the river. Okay, so if the width is 100, it should be multiplied by 4, which is about 400 meter. So at least 400 meter should be straight. Next one, the selection. The next point is that the section of the discharge should be well defined. Okay, so it should be a well defined section. Okay, it should be properly in terms of width, it should be properly in terms of depth. So the section should be proper and well defined. That is the second point which we need to remember selecting a site for discharge. Okay, the next one, the flow should be confined to a single channel. Bifurcation is not allowed. Okay, so it should be following a single route, it should not be bifurcated to some other route. That is one of the main criteria also. It should be following a single channel, it should not be bifurcated into one or two, three channels. Okay, the center line AA of the discharge site is marked with a target on both banks. Okay, so the fourth point is that the center line, let me show you the diagram over here. The diagram is there. The center line should be, the center line should be marked on the target on both the banks. So we need to mark the center line on both the sides of the bank, on this side also, on this side also. Okay, these are the four points which need to be remember while selecting a site for discharge purpose. Okay, now the next point is you're fixing the gauge post. So gauge posts are wooden posts basically of 10 centimeter into 5 centimeter, and the length is about 2 meter. The graduations is in meters and fractions of meter, so that minimum reading up to 0.1 meter can be taken. Okay, the posts are fixed in the series on a concrete foundation along the slope of the riverbank. As you can see, it has been shown in this diagram, it has been provided on the slopes. Okay, it has been marked with certain graduations. Okay, the bottom of the post is assumed to be zero, so the bottom post has been assumed to be zero, and the graduation accordingly. Next one, the RL of zero mark of the starting gauge post is determined by fly leveling. So the reduced level of the zero mark has been first determined with the help of fly leveling and benchmark. Then by simply nothing but reading the gauges, the RL of the water level can be predicted. So for example, if the zero mark is 115.25, so when the gauge reading is 1 meter, so if the gauge reading is coming out to be 1 meter, the level of water is what? 156.25. so 155.25 addition 1, that will give you the level of your water. Okay, this is how your gauge post work. Basically the gauge posts are of what? They are generally made of wooden. They are of this dimension, 10 centimeter by 15 centimeter, and the length is 2 meter. They are generally provided with a graduation which can mark up to 0.01. okay, they are generally fixed in series in slopes. Okay, the zero has been marked on the starting gauge. The zero level has been generally marked on the starting gauge with the help of fly leveling. You have to perform fly leveling in order to get the level of zero line. Okay, and once you have got the zero line, with the help of graduation, you can get the level of water. There is a small example given over here. With the help of that, you can understand that. So this is your river gauging. Now how to do the measurement of depth of water. So various instruments are available by which you can measure the depth of your water bodies. The first instrument, it is called as your sounding rod. It is a wooden rod or bamboo pole of 5 centimeter diameter. It is generally a 5 centimeter diameter and 2.5 meter length. It provides a disc of 15 centimeter at the bottom. So a disc has been provided at the bottom of your sounding rod. It is graduated in 1 and 10th of the meter. Okay, so graduations are been marked on the rod. The sounding rod is suitable for measuring the depth of small rivers. So sounding rod is generally used for what? Small rivers which is having a depth of about 2 meter. To measure the depth, the sounding rod is slowly immersed vertically from the board and at the required plates, so that the base of the plate just touches the river bed, and the depth of the water can be noted from the graduation. Okay, so there is a diagram over here. You can see that there is an observer which is using this sounding rod, and it has been slowly immersing vertically in your river, and when it is touching the river bed, you can see that there is graduation mark on the sounding rod. With the help of this graduation, we can measure the depth of your river. Okay, so sounding rod basically is generally done for small rivers which is having a depth of around 2 meter or less. Then there is sounding cable when the depth of water is more than 2 meter. So if it is more than 2 meter, the water current is high, the velocity rod is not practicable. So here you cannot use your sounding rod. So in case a cable or rope is released slowly from the boat, so what you have to do, you have to release a cable from the boat, okay, with a weight of about 5 kg, so that it get immersed perfectly inside the water. When the weight just touches the bottom of the river bed, a mark is been marked on the cable. So you have to mark wherever it is touching the ground, you have to mark the cable, and then the depth has been measured with the help of tape. Then you have to measure the mark and this weight with the help of your tapes, so we'll get the depth of your river. So this is your sounding cable, and it is normally used when the sounding rod is not applicable. Okay, it is generally done for a depth of more than 2 meters. The next type of instrument is called as your eco sounder. Eco sounder is used for measuring the depth of large river. So in case of large river which is having a depth more than 10 meters, you will have to use eco sounder. An electrical instrument, it is an electrical instrument in which the sound impulse from the surface of the water is sent towards the bottom of the river. So what you have to do, with the help of eco sounder, some sound waves are being transmitted inside the water, okay, and this sound wave waves travels from the boat to the bottom of the river bed, and ultimately with the help with the reflection, they get received back to the receiver of that eco sounder, and with the help of that, they are able to determine the depth of the river by using some calculations. So sounding waves are reflected back from the river bed in the form of echo, which are arrested by the receiver. This is an automatic recording of time and onwards and backward travel of the sound wave. So with the help of this, you can also find out your depth of the river. So we have got three instruments. One is your echo sounder. When the depth is more than 10 meter, then there is sounding cable. When the depth is more than 2 meter, and when the depth is 2 meter or less than 2 meter, sounding rod is being used. Okay, so there are diagrams also shown over here how to use your sounding rod and sounding cable and your eco sounder. Next, then sometimes it is also required to measure the velocity of flow. So velocity of flow can be measured by the following methods. There are 4 to 5 methods available with the help of which you can measure the velocity of flow. And the first one is the surface float method. Second is the subsurface float method. Next is your velocity rod method. Next is your pitot tube method. And last one is your current meter method. Okay, so we will see one by one how your measurement of velocity has been done. So first one is your surface float method. Surface float generally made up of cork, which can easily float on the water surface. So basically, these floats are been made in such a way that they can easily float on the water. Okay, they are generally in the form of 10 centimeter cube. So it is having a shape of a cube, which is having a size of 10 centimeter each. The floats are painted red and white. Okay, so floats are been painted red and white, and have a small flag attached on the top. So there is a small flag which has been attached on the top. The next thing, velocity is measured in the following way. At the discharge site, a rope has been stretched between two poles, fixed on both the bank of the river, and the water section is divided into several compartments by hanging zero. So you can see that there is several compartments, there is two poles are been marked, and there is a rope been stretched between these two sections. After that, next one, the velocity of each component is measured by the float, which is released slightly ahead of the cross section one. Okay, so you will have to release the float. So you will get a velocity for this cross section, you will get a velocity for this cross section, you will get a velocity at this cross section. Okay, next one, The velocity of each component is measured by the float, which is released slightly ahead of cross-section 1. The float just crosses the section, the stopwatch is started. So as soon as your float start moving from the cross-section, your stopwatch has been started. And when it crosses, when it just crosses the cross-section 2, what you will have to do, you will have to stop your stopwatch. And the time taken by the float to cover the run is noted, and from this the velocity is calculated. Okay, so how much time it required from this cross section to this cross section, that time has been noted, and with the help of that your velocity has been determined. Similarly, the velocity of all compartments are measured and the average of these are taken. So number of there, because there are number of cross sections, so you'll have to take the average value of the measurement of flow. Okay, the next method is your subsurface float method. In this subsurface float method, the subsurface float is a hollow cylinder which has been attached by a cord to a surface float. So there is a hollow cylinder which has been attached to a float. The position of subsurface float is adjusted according to the depth of the river. So the position, how to keep the subsurface float, has been adjusted with the help of your depth of the river. Generally it is kept at a 0.2 meter above the bottom. So it is kept at a height of 0.2 from the bottom. In this case, the measured velocity is equal to the mean velocity. Okay, so you have to take what the velocity is generally taken equal to the mean velocity. The procedure of measurement is the same as that of the float method. So the only thing, the procedure is totally same as compared to your float method. Okay, only thing is that it consists of a hollow cylinder, it has been attached to a float, and it is kept at a height of 0.2 from the bottom of the bed. Next one, the velocity rod meter. The velocity rod is made up of hollow metal. Okay, so this is the velocity rod. It is made up of a hollow metal or a wood. Its diameter is about 2.5 to 5 centimeters. So the 2.5 to 5 centimeter diameter. A weight has been provided at the bottom of the rod, which keeps it vertical. So some weight has been provided at the bottom, which keeps it vertical. The rod is generally submerged to extent of 0.6 d. So there is a certain criteria to submerge the rod. It should be at least 0.6 d inside the water. The procedure for measurement is exactly same as that of surface float. Other things are similar to your surface float method. Okay, next one is your Pitot tube method. The Pitot tube is a glass tube bent at an angle of 90 degree at the lower end. So you can see this is a Pitot tube. The upper end is open. So upper end has been open, and the lower portion has been kept inside the water. The lower end is in the form of a nozzle, and it is directly upstream. So the water whichever coming is coming from this leg of your Pitot tube. Due to the velocity of water, the water column rises. So you can see that because it is moving, as the water coming inside your Pitot tube, the water will rise in this leg. Okay, and with the help of this height, you can calculate what the amount velocity by applying what Bernoulli's theorem. You can calculate what is the velocity of your flow with the help of Pitot tube method. The next one, this is the formula for your Bernoulli's theorem. Then last one is your current meter method. The price current meter is commonly used for measurement of velocity flow. This is the instrument. This is how it is look. It consists of the following component: a tail which keeps the meter in the direction of alignment. So in order to maintain the direction, this tail has been used. Next one, a system of conical bucket fitted to a spindle which rotates due to current. So you can see that there is a conical bucket spindle. So whenever water is coming at this side, it will rotate. Okay. Next one, a counterweight which keeps the meter vertical. So there is a small weight provided at the bottom so that it is being kept vertical. Next, the headphone for registering the sound produced by the spindle at every revolution. Okay. So this spindle has been attached to a headphone. Okay. So when this rotates, it gives a sound, and that sound is to be recorded. Okay, the current meter has been lowered at a depth of 0.6 meter. So there is a condition also that it should be at least submerged at a depth of 0.6 meter with the help of suspension cable. The system of conical bucket is kept on the upstream side. So this conical bucket has been kept on the upstream side where the flow of water has been coming. Due to the velocity of water, the conical system bucket rotates about the spindle and a tick sound has been emitted once for every revolution. So whenever it revolves whenever it completes one revolution, you will get a sound of tick, okay, and that can be heard with this headphone, and the amount of tick is to be recorded with the help of this headphone, and which will give you your velocity value, okay. Thus the continuous tick tick sound is heard through the headphone, the number of revolution per minute. So you will have to calculate what the number of revolution, how many revolution has been completed in 1 minute with the help of stopwatch. The velocity can be ascertained from the rating table. So there is a rating table provided there with the help of which you can get the velocity by using what your current meter method. Okay. So the last part in this hydrographic surveying is related to your marine surveying. So the marine surveying involves the following part. The shoreline at low and high tide has been marked. So a shoreline has been created during a low and high tide mark. Then open traverse conducted by compass. So then you will have to use an open compass, open traverse. You have to create an open traverse by the help of compass or theodolite light to obtain the configuration of shoreline. Okay. Then next, the depth of water around the harbor area is determined by eco sounder and observation, like large rocks, sandbars, etc. are located. So with the help of eco sounder, we will find out the depth and we will obstruct if there is any obstruction like rocks, sandbars, etc. are to be located. The current and tidal observations are taken to identify the nature of the sea water and take necessary precaution for safe movement of the ship. So why it is important? Because how is your sea behaving, what is the nature of your sea, that is required to be predicted, otherwise it will affect your the movement of your ship. So for that purpose, current and tidal observations are taken. Next one, the positions where lighthouses are to be set up for identification of sea route for a ship from one port to another established. So the position of large rocks, submerged hills, sandbar, etc. are located by measuring the depth of the eco sounder and other appliances. So you also need to fix the position of lighthouse, that will give you the safe route for the movement of the ship. So that for that purpose your marine surveying has been done. Then next, the profile of the bottom of the sea has been prepared by depth recording instrument mounted on a motorboat streaming along the predetermined alignment fixed by the compass. Soundings are taken at regular interval and recorded. Next, the maps are prepared to indicate the position of submerged hill, sandbars or other obstruction. The safe route is indicated on the map by showing the position of lighthouse. The profile of the seabed has been prepared for navigation guidance. So basically, marine surveying basically includes that it should provide a proper routes to your ship. Okay. It should provide a map which is showing that if there is any hill submerged below or any sandbar is being submerged below, okay, and it also provides some data related to your sea, how is the nature of the sea, okay, whenever there is chances of high tide, whenever there is chances of low tide, that information has been given in marine surveying. So these are all included in marine surveying. Okay, so here I complete my your last unit, which includes your hydrographic surveying. I think you have done almost everything related to your hydrographic surveying. Thank you so much.